Welcome to the FoxLearn. Today we will learn how to use async and await. First, you need to add a button and text box to form 1. The text box displays some messages when you click Start button. You can avoid performance bottlenecks and enhance the overall responsiveness of your application by using asynchronous programming. However, traditional techniques for writing asynchronous applications can be complicated, making them difficult to write, debug, and maintain. Visual Studio 2012 introduces a simplified approach, async programming, that leverages asynchronous support in the .NET Framework 4.5 and the Windows runtime. The compiler does the difficult work that the developer used to do, and your application retains a logical structure that resembles synchronous code. As a result, you get all the advantages of asynchronous programming with a fraction of the effort. Asynchrony is essential for activities that are potentially blocking, such as when your application accesses the web. Access to a web resource sometimes is slow or delayed. If such an activity is blocked within a synchronous process, the entire application must wait. In an asynchronous process, the application can continue with other work that doesn't depend on the web resource until the potentially blocking task finishes. The async and await keywords are the heart of async programming. By using those two keywords, you can use resources in the .NET framework or the Windows runtime to create an asynchronous method almost as easily as you create a synchronous method. Asynchronous methods that you define by using async and await are referred to as async methods. The install async method will return a value like total component installed. In async methods, you use the provided keywords and types to indicate what you want to do, and the compiler does the rest, including keeping track of what must happen when control returns to an await point in a suspended method. Some routine processes, such as loops and exception handling, can be difficult to handle in traditional asynchronous code. In an async method, you write these elements much as you would in a synchronous solution, and the problem is solved. Async methods are intended to be non-blocking operations. An await expression in an async method doesn't block the current thread while the awaited task is running. Instead, the expression signs up the rest of the method as a continuation and returns control to the caller of the async method. The async and await keywords don't cause additional threads to be created. Async methods don't require multi-threading because an async method doesn't run on its own thread. The method runs on the current synchronization context and uses time on the thread only when the method is active. You can use taskRun to move CPU-bound work to a background thread, but a background thread doesn't help with a process that's just waiting for results to become available. The async-based approach to asynchronous programming is preferable to existing approaches in almost every case. In particular, this approach is better than background worker for IO-bound operations because the code is simpler and you don't have to guard against race conditions. In combination with taskRun, async programming is better than background worker for CPU-bound operations because async programming separates the coordination details of running your code from the work that taskRun transfers to the thread pool. we will debug the program. The most important thing to understand in asynchronous programming is how the control flow moves from method to method. Thank you for watching this video.